abuse and GBVF. Can we please give Auntie Cheryl?
Our auntie now.
Our auntie now.
Yeah, doctor. Yeah, doctor.
Yes, Auntie Cheryl.
Yes, Auntie Cheryl.
Is it morning? Is it morning? Afternoon? It's still morning.
Still morning.
Is it afternoon?
Is it afternoon?
No, not yet.
Not yet.
Good morning,
good
everyone.
Good morning, everyone.
Yes, yes.
Thank you so much. Allow me to say thank you to Act, the team, for giving me the opportunity to be here. I was chatting to some of my colleagues sitting around the table, and I said I'm normally not one that does presentations. I'm an action person. Because I feel sometimes presentations is enough. We like have an overdrive of presentations. But sometimes we need to do this. Now, I'll give you a bit of background. My name is Cheryl Pillay. I'm the chairperson of the Eldorado Park Local Drug Action Committee. I also serve on the Gauteng Substance Abuse Forum, as well as the founder of Comeback Mission, which all deals with substance-related issues. And we know that substance abuse in our country is one of those things that causes us the most pain on every level. So substance abuse doesn't need a conference. Substance abuse doesn't need a place to sit around and have conversations or things like that all the time. Substance abuse needs action to be taken so that we can start eradicating substance out of our communities. So I'm going to speak today about the linkage of the use of substance and gender-based violence and femicide. And I think we all know somebody that is a very good man, well-dressed, very respected. When he comes in at the door, him and his partner look stunning. They're the best couple for that day at the event. But sadly, after an hour, it becomes a different story at the event. And that's what I'm going to address today. But I'm just going to go onto the slide for background to what I'm talking about. Okay. So with South Africa's high crime stats, the linkages between violent crimes and gender-based violence on one hand and substance abuse on the other should not be underestimated. Indeed, substance abuse transcends racial, class, and gender divides and affects all areas of life. And this reality points to the fact that the problem is far-reaching and deeply entrenched. I spoke about class, race, it doesn't matter who we are. The relationship between alcohol abuse and the perpetration of gender-based violence is of particular concern. For example, women with male partners who come home drunk frequently are 4 to 7 times more likely to suffer violence. Intimate partner violence perpetrators are 5 times more likely than non-perpetrators to consume alcohol. Men with alcohol problems are generally more likely to commit intimate partner violence, and male-to-female aggression is 11 times more likely to occur on days when the perpetrators were drinking alcohol. Additionally, there are proven links between alcohol abuse and the transmission of HIV and AIDS, HIV, compared with non-drinkers. Non-problem drinkers had 1.6-fold higher HIV prevalence, while problem drinkers had 2-fold higher prevalence. It is therefore clear that excessive alcohol consumption is a serious health, public health issue. linkages to gender-based violence and femicide. Studies have shown that regions with lower alcohol use have lower HIV rates, and that lessening alcohol use can reduce the incidence of gender-based violence. Alcohol abuse prevention mechanisms are therefore crucial, especially in South Africa, which has one of the highest alcohol consumption rates in the world. According to World Health Organization, pure alcohol consumption per liter in South Africa is at 11.5, which pushes South Africa up to the third biggest drinking nation in Africa. That's horrific. And the 19th biggest drinking nation in the world. Furthermore, research shows that more than a quarter of the drinking population in South Africa are considered binge drinkers. Now, we know when we go to the parties and the first bottle of Chivas comes out, or Johnny Walker's or whatever, Johnny Walker Black and Red, it almost looks like there's a status if we can put six bottles on the table and all six bottles are finished by the time. You know, they actually make it's like a medal. We finished six bottles of Johnny Walker Black Label. Can we walk through that? And that's the binge drinking in South Africa. We don't have a bottle of wine and have a glass and have dinner and go home. We need to have the medals for the tables, the trophies. And that's why binge drinking in South Africa is one of the biggest problems we have. Drivers of gender-based violence and femicide. The relationship between substance abuse and gender-based violence in South Africa is acknowledged and well documented. Studies linking alcohol consumption and intimate partner violence have found that 45% of men and 20% of women were drinking during episodes of intimate partner violence. In 2006 in South Africa, 70% of domestic violence cases were alcohol-related, and a fifth of offenders arrested for rape reported that they were under the influence of alcohol at the time of the crime. Research shows that intimate partner violence is five times higher in relationships where one or both partners abuses alcohol. Alcohol abuse among men, as well as intimate partner violence, is often a manifestation of an underlying need for power, we heard it earlier, and control related to gender-based inequalities and insecurities. So we're not making an excuse about the substance. There's underlying issues that we need to deal with. A key entry point in dealing with gender-based violence, crime and urban violence may be addressing drug and alcohol abuse. And I think that for me is where I come in, where it is so crucial and critical. While substance abuse is not the underlying cause of such violence, it is often a critical catalyst for violence in South Africa. So a lot of times there's no conversation happening, and we know those people at the parties. They don't talk at all when they are sober. They won't get onto the dance floor. They won't do anything but give them three or four glasses of wine, and later on that person is the belle of the ball. We know that people I'm speaking about? Do we know them? And that very person now responds in the manner that he might have wanted to respond when there was the issue. We heard about it just now, when the bad wolf starts coming up, and then the alcohol actually gives him now the vuma to do that. And suddenly this person can tell you what and who he is, where he wasn't there before. So in essence, the alcohol just loosens the person up to what it is. And it's that very same person that we look up to when he's sober, when he's sitting in the office, when he's at a meeting, that very person turns into that big bad hoof that very moment when he's gone through his alcohol consumption levels, that binge drinking. What are we going to do about that? Because we cannot continue to have this kind of behavior. I think we need to look at implementing stricter rules when it comes to the use of substance and alcohol. I know in 2010 the country went into lockdown. And one of the lockdown issues was to stop alcohol. Now, why did the president say stop alcohol? Why did we stop alcohol? Because our health system couldn't deal with the intake of COVID-related cases in the hospitals. And our emergency service at our public hospitals spoke to the slow or hardly any cases of gender-based violence that was substance-related that came into the ER rooms. Do you agree with me? We saw that. We saw that there was less cases that went to that emergency rooms because substance was stopped. Although we know there was a lot of black market substance going, alcohol sales going around. But that just gave us a bit of an understanding that alcohol is one of the driving factors to gender-based violence and femicide. The other issue is there sufficient and accessible treatment programs available for men in our area? And if yes, would you make use of the services? The one problem we have is that people don't want to tap into the resources until their backs is up against the wall. When there's an arrest made and the magistrate has to grant an order that you need to seek treatment is the time that we look at it. But I think we need to start changing our mindsets. We need to start educating from a young age that counseling and support groups is of critical importance to deal with situations. We shouldn't make as if, when you speak to someone, say, there's nothing wrong with me, you know, I'm not an alcoholic. Or there's nothing wrong with me, I'm not mad, I don't need a psychiatrist or a psychologist. We need to take that stigma away. And we need to bring those services closer into our communities. We need to start making it accessible that people will want to tap into those resources and have those discussions. And I think places that we need to start with those discussions is in our churches, it's in our mosques. We need to start addressing the elephants in the room and not just preach it away, because many times we just want to preach it away. Many times it is for people outside and not the people inside. The very people in those places are the people that are suffering. Each person in your church is sitting next to a pool of tears. The imam in the mosque has a front line to the males that comes to pray there. When are we going to say it is okay to address these situations? You don't need to be afraid and you don't need to be shy. Start opening up those conversations on the ground and in the places where it matters the most. There is help available. We have the Department of Social Development and they're right here with toll-free lines. But sometimes toll-free lines is not what makes it for us. We need the action. So I believe in this room there's enough NGOs, NPOs, organizations that needs to become relevant to the communities where we serve. We need to be relevant there. You know, sometimes a toll-free line is okay. But when you are in distress and you need help, you want to almost have a face-to-face first response person that can deal with your situation. So for me, we need to create first response. responder teams in our various communities that will deal with gender-based violence. I've left some numbers on the screen there, and I will give the numbers available: Tranquility Clinic, Comeback Mission, SANCA, and NA meetings. But to close off today, I want to challenge the NGOs, NPOs, organizations. Let's go back to our communities. Let's start first responder groups to address gender-based violence. So when there's a call that comes out, we don't need to wait for police to respond, because that will take 4 hours. We need to have teams on the ground that is ready to respond and make the difference. Thank you.
I think we all now understand why they call her Auntie Cheryl, right? Definitely Auntie Cheryl. Wow, thank you so much for that. Thank you. Our next speaker is he ready, or you'll sing him? Okay. So our next speaker, I do apologize in advance. I tried to rehearse this name to learn how to pronounce it. Ish, I struggle. I promise to dance with you. I would like to call Colonel ... I apologize. Yeah, you're putting me on the spot here. Colonel, you're really putting me on the spot. I'll read your profile and you'll stand up. National Human Trafficking Coordinator, Human Trafficking Series Organized Crime Directorate of Priority Crime Investigation. Still not coming. I'll promise, I'll dance with you. Thank you. Please, let's clap for him. How do I pronounce your name,
XA
name?
My name is Abigail Mokwane. I'm going to introduce
Senator. Oh, okay. You're going to introduce. Thank you.
Thank you, Program Director. Let me take this opportunity to say good morning to all of you, the leadership of ACT, MEC in absentia, all organizations present, our Pastor Moruti, Giridumelang, all of you, Sanbonan. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all the organizers of this event for inviting the Directorate for Priority Crime Investigation, known as the Hawks, to this event. Ladies and gentlemen, before I can start, I would like to introduce myself. I'm Brigadier Makuane. I'm the section head for the Economic Protected Resources in DPCI. My section is responsible for, amongst others, human trafficking. If I can take it further, DPCI was established as an independent directorate within the SAPS, is to deal and combating an investigation of national priority crime, that is serious corruption, serious organized crime, and serious commercial crime. And then the directorate was established in terms of Section 17B and D of the South African Police Act as amended. Trafficking in person, ladies and gentlemen, is a crime that is being declared as one of the operational priorities. DPCI has adopted a multidisciplinary approach and integrated approach in terms of strengthening and collaboration, cooperation in addressing the national priority crime. According to the DPCI strategic framework 2015-2019 outlined the objectives and strategic framework of the DPCI. The trafficking in person division is also based on a prevention, protection, and partnership. A multidisciplinary forum has been established to oversee the collaboration. As the MEC has already indicated that we as government, we cannot fight crime alone. So there must be a collaboration. So there is a forum that consists of department and agencies that is working on human trafficking. At the SADAG region, South Africa participate actively and in the SAPCO to deal with transnational organized crime. To give this effect, ladies and gentlemen, South Africa's obligation in terms of the UN protocol, Trafficking in Person and Combating of Human of Trafficking in Person Act 7 of 2013 was passed on the 9th of August 2015. In this regard, the sectorial committee is fully operational. We as DPCI, ladies and gentlemen, we have rescued many victims of human trafficking, and then we are having good convictions to deal with human trafficking cases. As part of intervention, the South African government with UNODC conducted awareness campaign at communities that are actively smuggling activities. Ladies and gentlemen, with those few words, I would like to call upon Colonel Jagua, who is the section commander and the national coordinator of human trafficking. He is going to give us a presentation on how we as DPCI, we are dealing with human trafficking. And as one of the things that were said today, myself and management of DPCI, we pledge that we say no to gender-based violence. I thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I've been introduced. I'm not going to introduce myself any further. What I'm going to try and do is run through this presentation a bit quick, right? I know you'll say that South African Indians talk fast. So I want the rest of the South Africans to listen quicker. Sit on. Right, so this is just my little CV that I've given to you. The presentation is available to everyone, so you can get my details, right? Please do not call me at 2 o'clock in the morning. I won't answer. Right, but that's just on a jerky note. We're available 24/7. So what I'm giving you is what is the reality of organized crime in South Africa and in the world. So a leading author called Jeffrey Robinson, who wrote the book The Merger, he indicates that we are in serious trouble in the 21st century. Why? Because the Holy Organized Crime Alliance has decided to take over the world. And we, who are the biggest family in the world, which is called law enforcement, okay. So we, as the biggest family in the world, is law enforcement. We are the most uncoordinated, the most selfish, family in the world. We do not unite. And this is what happens, because if you look at the bad guys got all the money. Am I right or wrong? Hey? And they've got no rules. You'll find a criminal will liaise with a criminal, and they don't even know each other, and yet they will lend each other a stolen car or $1 million. Yet law enforcement, who has all the rules, and no money, unfortunately, they are sitting in a discoordinated fashion. So this is a brilliant book to read. It also touches on South Africa as well. So we need to get together. And how are we going to get together? Law enforcement, civil society needs to join hands, and the general public as well. We need to join forces. We need to be what our learned colleague said there about the good wolf. So we need the good wolf as well to come in through. Right? Human trafficking is the second most profitable organized crime commodity in the world. What happened is that it was first narcotics, and after narcotics came your gun trafficking. Human trafficking has overtaken it. The last figure that we had was in 2018, is that human trafficking generated almost $150 billion. This is what law enforcement knows, and this is what law enforcement gets from their law enforcement agencies throughout the world. What about those that are not detected by law enforcement? What is those figures, amounting to? We have a very poor conviction rate throughout the world, not only in South Africa, but throughout the world. Cases are taking too long. Victims eventually get frustrated. Victims are intimidated, and they pull out of the whole court process. That's why our conviction rate comes a bit down, right? And then we look at, there's been an increase in the child and labor exploitation. So slavery in the early centuries is now repeating itself in a modern day society. And lots of us are contributors to it. How many of us pay our domestics their basic wage and their benefits? Think about it. Some of us are nodding our heads, Yashel. Right, so let's get on to the basics of what the South African police obligation together with the directorate, right? One of the things is that the Trafficking in Persons Act, I'm going to call it the TIP Act, right? So it's in the full form, it's the Prevention and Combating of Trafficking in Persons Act, Act 7 of 2013. So in terms of Section 44.2, the National Commission of the South African Police Service is obligated to issue national instructions. The national instructions guides the police and the DPCI. It obligates them as well on certain issues, right? We must afford assistance to a victim of trafficking. We must investigate. And it's not only for human trafficking, but related issues within the trafficking environment. One of the other issues is that we must also partake in what we call the NICTIP. Now, the NICTIP is the National Intersectorial Committee on Trafficking in Persons. It's a national body that governs and executes the national policy framework of human trafficking. And within the 9 provinces, you find that they got the provincial task teams that get together every month or every second month, and they basically enhance their capacity to prevent and combat trafficking in persons. Right, now let's go down, right down to the frontliners, because in any crime, we need frontline police action. And the frontline police action starts. So let's look at the station commander. What is his rules and what is his obligations? Very similar to gender-based violence, he must have the following documents. He must have a copy of the Trafficking in Persons Act. He must have the national instructions, right? He must also have the designated child protection and places of safety. He must have a list. It must be accredited by the Department of Social Development, right? They've got their rules and regulations as to how it has to be accredited, right? Then one of the issues that he must have is that he must have an assigned detective at every police station. So I'm going to repeat.
a detective at every police station must be assigned to be responsible to respond to a human trafficking matter, right? This in turn leads us that even further on, that he must draft an action plan. He must have an action plan and say, like, this is what we're going to deal when we get a trafficking in persons matter. It's very similar to what we did when we had gender-based violence way back in 1998 when the legislations came into power, right? And we were trained on it. So the same thing is going to happen there. And he's responsible for the training as well, right? So one of the issues is that who are the role players? So the first one is that the station commander takes charge, right? He's the leadership of the station, and he must make sure that everything is in place. He must have the documents, right? He must have the training. And the last one, which is the most important part, he must make sure there's compliance by his detectives and his role, well, all other role players. Visible policing, for those of y'all who do not understand the terminology, we're looking at the frontline police officers. The man that knocks on your door when you complain that your cat is up in the roof and you want assistance. I wonder if they'll assist you, but they will, right? Then we're looking at the detective services. Now within the detective services, we have the general detectives. We're telling you it's the general detectives. They are responsible for an adult victim. That means the moment there's a victim of trafficking person, they deal with it. When there is a child victim, the matter goes over to the Family, Child and Sexual Offences Unit, previously known as the Child Protection Unit, and then they went on and changed the names. But basically, these are the people that will deal with it. Now, what we're saying is that when we start the process, right, the next portion of it, so I told you about the state, about the detail, the station commander. From the station commander, I told you about the role players. Now we're coming to the part of the DPCI. How does the DPCI respond about the whole issue? One of the things is that I, as a national coordinator, I have to consolidate all the provincial reports, and we have to, in turn, report it to what we call our Priority Crime Management Center. They filter it, and it is sent to the Department of Justice. The Department of Justice is responsible to ensure that an annual report is tabled in Parliament to show the parliamentarians whether the legislation that they have empowered us with, is it working or not? Is there a need to change it, right? At the provincial level, you'll find there is a provincial coordinator. So in South Africa, there are 9 DPCI provincial coordinators who are the guardians of trafficking in persons. Every single trafficking in person case must be reported to the DPCI coordinator. We in turn have to look and ensure that that docket or that case, does it belong to the DPCI or does it belong to the detectives or the FCS? And we are also obligated to ensure that in the time when we decide that this case does not belong to the DPCI, that it belongs to the detectives or to FCS, that we will render the necessary assistance to further that investigation. Now we talk about our case policy selection. How does the DPCI? The DPCI, as remember, is mandated to investigate cases that are of a transnational level. That means it's crossing from South Africa to another, whether it is regional or whether it is intercontinental. Then we're looking at where it is of an organized crime syndicate, where there is a network, there's a hierarchy, there's a boss, and there's runners below him. And this is now one big organized crime syndicate. That's when we will step into the whole issue. Or when the complexity of the case merits that it needs either a multidisciplinary, that means we must join hands with either the FCS or the detectives to investigate the matter. So there's not to say that we as a DPCI, we are passing the buck. It's not about passing on the buck. It's about maintaining the buck. That's what it's all about. We want control over the cases, and we want to ensure that these cases are successfully prosecuted. We come quickly to the reporting process. How does a person report? in person, right? So someone comes into the community service center and they want to now lay a complaint. Or we'll find they come from the telephone, from the email, the letter, any method that you would want to report, it is done through. And it's also done through confidential and anonymous means. And these now are going through our SEPs. Or it's going to the DPCI. Or it is going to Crime Stop. Or it's going to our non-governmental organizations. One of them that is very, very vocal and assistant to us is called the National Human Trafficking Hotline, right? Then we look at the activation process, and someone said, take the person away. So same thing with gender-based violence. We in human trafficking, same thing you do. Take your victim away. Why? Remove that victim from his or her trauma area. You'll find that the area where you are, whether you're in the home, whether you're in the brothel, whether you are in the factory, or whether you're even in the hospital, right? We can always take you to the hospital, and the hospital is a place of trauma. Why? Way back in 2000, we found that professional doctors from Netcare were in collusion with Israelites who had South American victims, and they're removing their organs. So the hospital is also a place of trauma, right? Make sure that the person gets immediate medical attention. That is your priority. As law enforcement, or even you as a community, if you find that you're removing this person, take that person. You're not the doctor. Let them get the necessary medical assistance. Let's determine, are they medically affected, are they emotionally affected, or otherwise? So this is the job. Take them away from there, and that's how you start reassuring the person that you are the person that's going to care for them, and that they will give you the cooperation. They will tell you what's happening. Often you find human trafficking victims are petrified to tell another person, because the amount of fear that your trafficker inspires into you is unbelievable. It is just a very similar thing that where we, as an adult, we are abusing our daughters or our sons in a home environment. Same thing happens with human trafficking. There's a lot of similarities that I can tell you is what about gender-based violence and about human trafficking, right? And then we look at obtaining the state. I'm not going to go through all this, but what I want to show you something. Right, so let's go back, right? So one of the issues of a child victim, very, very important, is you need to remove that child as quickly as possible. Now, we as law enforcement, we don't need court orders. We are able to use other legislations in order to remove the child. And then we need to contact the Department of Social Development immediately, right? And that must be also an accredited organization. We must inform SEPs. And SEPs, and particularly the FCS, must take charge of this investigation. As I indicated there, National Instruction 4 of 2015 obligates us. So this is what it's all about. And we have to keep records in all the places. I know you want me out, eh? But it's a long slide. Why are we going backward? Let's see. Okay, so I'm going to talk about us. I want to market the DPCI, right? So this is what we're all about. We are not just a detection, entity, but awareness campaigns. Just last year, we went to Park Station and we had an awareness campaign, and we reached out to over 400 people. So 400 people in Johannesburg is well equipped, because we told them what trafficking is all about. And this is what it's all about. It's about spreading the gospel. This whole conference is about spreading the gospel. And so we also are reaching out, and I went out even to tertiary educations where we had virtual meetings due to COVID interference. We had to go out, right? We also do the rescues. And part of the rescues and the repatriation is that when I was in Johannesburg, when I was based at the provincial office, we took 10 Chinese females out of a brothel. And when I was standing at OR Tambu, the triads, and some of you that do not know who are the triads, they're basically the Chinese mafia, was standing there. That when the victim landed in Hong Kong, she phoned her mother, and the mother said, daughter, do not come to the house. The people want to know whether you came back from South Africa. That's how quick traffickers work, right? arrest, we are instrumental in arresting our people. And we make sure that we arrest anyone and everyone, including our own. That this year we arrested a high-ranking brigadier and a captain that were involved in trafficking in the Valran area. So we're not going to leave any stone unturned. We will topple anything, and that's what we're all about. But we also need your assistance on the whole issue. When it comes to convictions, just recently we convicted two Nigerians. The one Nigerian got a double life sentence, and the other one got a life sentence. So for your information, the Trafficking Act stipulates that if you contravene Section 4.1 of the Trafficking Act, which is the basic crime of trafficking persons, a life sentence can be imposed upon you, right? So I want to leave you with some startling news. There was a girl of only 14 years old, Nepalese. She was forced to marry a man of 40 years old. She ran away. She went back to the father. The father refused to accept his whole principle. And if you know a lot about Asian law, indigenous law, you are bringing the family to disrepute. He tied her up to a tree and he started digging a hole. And it wasn't through the neighbor that heard her screams. This child will surely have been buried alive. Then we've got a 12-year-old Indian lady, an Indian miner. Her mother gave over her to a family friend. And the family friend decided to prostitute the child. Right? We look at a 17-year-old from the Eastern European bloc. Her abusive mother, substance abuse, Cheryl, right? And she, with her stepfather, with her boyfriend, they decided to experiment on this child on a sexual note. And when they rescued her, three-quarters of her reproductive organs had to be removed. Then recently we had in the Eastern Cape where a woman that gave birth to twins, 28 days old, she decided to give it to another couple for adoption for a lousy 50 rand a month. This is what life is all about. Is 50 rand worth your life? Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much. Colonel, before you go, I have to find him. I've been standing and saying time is up. So he's going to dance with me. This is a men's conference after all. We have not seen the gents moving. They've been sitting down. So you're going to represent the gents for me. Please. Sound. This is his punishment. Sound guy, please. Is that what he's dancing to? Yes. I don't think he represented you. I need a gent that's gonna volunteer. Craig, do you wanna, you know, it's a men's conference after all. Please stand up and dance with Craig, come on. Sound, please. Nice song. Come, Craig. Woo!
Everybody, you can look on the list, I'm not there, but I'm most grateful to Hillary, thank you. I was informed about this conference like 2 days ago, and I was like, why? But I'm the founder of an organization called Matrix Men. We were established in 2011, and it's the first organization in South Africa and Africa, in fact, that deals with male victims of sexual abuse and gender-based violence. And I started this organization because of my own life, my own experiences. I was sexually abused from the age of 5 to the age of 19 by men and women. And we tend to overlook this, and it was a problem for me because I looked for a place to go and find healing, and there was none. You know, and I have this men come into my offices and they say, you know, when you watch television, you see a lady that's been raped and her hair's all dir makar and she's bleeding and crying, and they take her off to hospital, and the nurses are also attentive, and oh, we're sorry, and the police come and they investigate. And he said, that's not my story. I'm a man who was raped in my own home by somebody I thought I could trust. We as society are not giving our boy victims permission to come and heal. We as society have sidelined because we've changed the meaning of a word. We've changed the meaning of a word. Gender no longer means little boys and little girls or women and men. It now, because we put two words behind it, based violence, means only woman. We need to, at our rape crisis centers, when I was 16 years old and I finally plucked up the courage after my first suicide attempt, first of five, I walked into the rape crisis center and I looked at all the posters on the wall, and all I saw were little girls, what I call the hairy fist picture. Aren't we all guilty of that, ladies and gentlemen? Where you see the little girl or the lady with the black eye cowering in the corner and the hairy fist in the front line. And I looked at these pictures and the lady came up to me and she said, can I help you? And I said, no, it's okay. And I walked out. And that set about a course in my life where, Auntie Cheryl, this is your sector, I started drinking to cope with the pain that I could not speak about because society tells me that I cannot be a victim, that I'm not allowed to cry. When I'm a little boy and I fall down and scratch my knee, my daddy says, what? The first thing, don't be a baby, stop crying. When my girl falls down and cries and scratches her knee, I'm like, oh, sorry, my baby. You say, oh, shame, you know. Why? And I was so encouraged when the MEC of DSD was talking about how she raises her boys and her girls the same. And it's so important that we allow our boys to cry, that we allow our boys to feel, that we allow our boys to speak. Okay? Now, I'm going to give you some stats. I want you all to sit down and brace yourselves. Right? In 2006, a research study was conducted in South Africa, and they were looking for the link between abuse, sexual abuse, and the spread of HIV/AIDS in South Africa, because we are the highest in the world, right? And they interviewed 126,000 boys. Well, it's 125,000, so many that I've forgotten the exact number. In 9 provinces, in 1,192 schools, in 9 official languages. And what was the outcome of the study? Every year in South Africa, 10% of all boys suffer some form of sexual abuse. That, ladies and gentlemen, breaks down to about 365,000 victims. Where are the rape crisis centers for our little boys? By the age of 18, 44% of all boys had suffered sexual abuse in some way, shape, or form. Right? 41% of them had been perpetrated on by females, 27% by both men and women, and 32% of them were victims of male perpetrators. Where are the rape crisis centers for little boys? And when I spoke to one of the researchers in that study and I said to him, what was the most shocking thing that came out of your study? He said, the fact that boys are 4 times more likely to perpetrate a rape. Why? With all the interventions that we're doing in terms of rape crisis centers and awareness and the 16 days of fascism, activism, sorry. Yeah. There was a purposeful slip, sorry. Right? With all these interventions, why are the stats not coming down? Well, they're going up. Every year they go up. We see more women being abused. We see more women being raped. That's why, because we're not fixing the broken little boys. Do you know, with all the gangs that we've got in this country, you know what the initiation for a little boy into a gang is? Gang rape. I had a paramedic phone me one day, and she's got a little boy. He's been raped by 11 boys, their friends. Where do I take him? I said, the hospital. How bloody sad is that? This little boy doesn't have a center where he can go to. This little boy cannot begin a healing process. He gets thrown to a system that cannot do forensics on boys, that doesn't believe that boys can be victims. And then what we do when he's an adult, a dysfunctional, alcoholic, drug-addicted adult who's violent, men are trash. Toxic masculinity. Well, when he was growing up, he never said, I want to be a rapist or an abusive husband. He said, I want to be a policeman, a doctor, a nurse, a fireman. Can you guys tell me, any one of your little boys wants to become a rapist when he's older? Yes? No? No. We all have great dreams. What breaks us and makes us become something different? I just want to see a show of hands. Who's got a son? Do you realize that your son is more at risk in this country than your daughter is? 44% of boys are raped in this country, 33% of girls. Thank you. I know you. Sorry to be the downer, but when we go into this and we talk about this, please remember that boys are victims too. Thank you very much.
Wow. Wow. Boys are victim too. Boys are victim too. There's a gentleman who asked for water in the kitchen. The ladies are ready for you so that you can take your medication. Please go that side. I'd like to call on Matthew to please come introduce our next speaker. Matthew, thank you so much. It's a men's conference, so you guys must dance. It's a men's conference, or the ladies are going to take over again. Yes, man. Yes, Martin. Yes. Hillary.
Good afternoon. I must say it was really very touching and very profound what you're saying just now. And it's true, like, you know, a lot of young boys go through a lot of terrible situations just like girls do. So I think it's very important for this process. I want to introduce someone who is a really fantastic person. I learn a lot from her on a daily basis. And she's really the drive behind what you see here today. And also for some of the other things we're doing. During this period of lockdown, we have been doing a lot of food relief in different underprivileged areas, especially to young kids. And she has an unstoppable passion and dedication for what she's do, and especially to support people that's less privileged than ourselves. I'd like to introduce the motor, the chairperson behind for ACT Africa, Hillary Leong.
Thank you. knows I cry very quickly. thank you. I'm gonna keep it quick. Colonel Jagua, thank you for the message you gave on human trafficking. Excellent, well done. Cheryl, your talk and all the other speakers as well, I just wanna say thank you. I'm just gonna give you a small clip, 1 minute clip, 60 second, also on trafficking. If our technical team can just show the clip and then I'll speak on
the International Labour Organization believes there are almost 21 million victims of trafficking around the world. The UN's most recent report found almost half of the victims were forced to work, typically in factories, restaurants and building sites. The majority, 53%, were exploited in the sex industry. 12 countries reported trafficking for organ removal. The rest of the victims were forced into petty crime or begging, or were children thrown into armed conflict. Victims are often trafficked within their own country, but many are taken from poorer countries to more affluent places in Northern America.
Just a pause. It wants you to concentrate on the map. Take note of the routes. Okay, I'll continue. So that is just a short snippet about your route trafficking, just to give you a quick idea. So you see how quick it happens, and it is not concentrated here. It is global. So our fight against human trafficking is global. Our fight against gender-based violence is global. Human trafficking is a complex form of gender-based violence, hence it being an organized crime, because of all the complexities involved, because of the number of people involved, the levels involved in trafficking a person. It's supply and demand, it's a business. Gender-based violence, normal, right? Domestic violence could even be human trafficking because you have husbands trafficking their wives, girlfriends, boyfriends trafficking each other, they're trafficking their children. And the prevalence of that has increased, especially now with the economic downturn. COVID-19, unfortunately, has presented itself. All of these kind of natural disasters, war-torn times, has the perfect storm. So we need to be very aware, and communication is key, parents. But I'm going to speak on choices. The choices we have as individuals, as men, as women, as children in our lives. We have a choice to look away. We have a choice to say, it's not my business. We have a choice to say, I want to get involved. We have a choice to say, I will report that incident. You don't have to be involved in an NPO. You don't have to do, all you need to do is be your brother's keeper, be your sister's keeper. Don't turn that blind eye. It could be you next, it could be your child next. The choice comes in where you think to yourself, it will never happen to me. Ach no, what's the chances? That's the famous thing. The chances are 99%, especially in the times that we are living in. And probably happening right under your nose, more so than what you think, and you just don't realize it. Or we sometimes are just blinded, or we don't recognize those signs. Or sometimes we go into denial. We know the denial thing. We just don't want to acknowledge it. It's human. It's normal. But there's always a way out. You make that choice, and a choice is a mindset change. It's you decide. It's not a feeling. It's not an emotion that comes up that you suddenly say, oh, I need to do this. We know right from wrong. So even if you have been abused and you've now become an abuser, so we use the reasoning or the excuse that because the person has been abused and they've become so, the cycle is continuing, you cannot help yourself or whatever. But you do know right from wrong. So you can make that right decision to stop. Stop that cycle, that negative cycle within yourself, within your family, your community, and that has a ripple effect right down into our economy. So when our gender-based violence statistics reduce, when our human trafficking statistics reduce, you see our economy will also start improving. Why? People in their workforces, in the workspace. I come from the corporate world. I dealt with volumes of staff, and I used to see what would happen. You cannot operate. So you cannot divorce the person's personal life from their work life because it affects it. They cannot operate optimally. And especially when there's something like gender-based violence, domestic violence in the home, any kind of abuse taking place, trafficking taking place. Most trafficking victims are silent, more silent so than the domestic violence because of the threat that lies behind it. The threat and also the desperation, they might be even earning money,
so
but
trapped in it,
and they'll keep quiet. They may not be locked in a room, it's not always like that. They may be going to school and back every day. They may be going to work and back every day, yet they are trapped. We need to learn these signs. As corporates need to make the decision, make the choice to get involved. So I thank every corporate here that you can see. Sun International, I want to raise that this is the first five-star hotel, Maslow. If not worldwide, that I know of, that has taken the stand together with all these organizations against human trafficking and gender-based violence. I really hope this will have a ripple effect in this industry. We have other companies. We have Accenture. These are companies in the corporate space that have taken the stand. They sit here today. I pray that you don't just do it as a CSR initiative, that you actually get involved in your employees' lives. You will see a difference in your business. Don't put profits before money. Put your people before your money. Your people generate your profits. Make the right choice. Your governments as well. Our NPOs that are working, we are working hard. We are trying, and we're doing this out of, it's a calling. It's not a job that we've applied for. It's a calling. God has called us for this purpose. So we've made that choice, and all we ask, support us. Support us as best as you can. Support us. Give us that base. Make that choice so that we can have a better South Africa. We can have a better Africa, and we can globally, our world can turn around. It's never too late. Make the right choice. Make that choice in your home. Start right there. Let's teach our children, and let's have that ripple effect. And like Cheryl said, grassroots, let's be on the ground. Don't wait for the next person. Don't wait for the NPO. Don't wait for the policeman. You can act. Act positively. We're not saying do a kangaroo court style. That's not the way. We have procedures. We know we have. Sometimes we want to do that. We have the walks. I work regularly. I work very closely with him. I have General Marshall, who's out at the moment with the president. He's engaging with me all the time, and they were out there with the elections. And he is such an activist against gender-based violence. We had an event, Walk a Mile in Her Shoes, and the powerful words he spoke. I don't even want to say, I really pray that he is able to make it today so that he can say those words to everybody. So those are the kind of people, and it's just the choices you make. It doesn't matter what your level is. It doesn't matter how many companies you own. It doesn't matter how many zeros you have in your bank account. It is irrelevant. That humanitarian choice, just to reach out to that person and make that life, make their lives a bit better. Even, it may not just be gender-based violence, it could be poverty, a slice of bread. That's all it, that makes a difference. It will make a world of difference. We've experienced it, Matthew and I, as we've gone along with our poverty relief. We've seen so much where you just take things for granted, where a simple thing, where a little three-in-one bottle that has meals where we haven't had food packs. We've had three-in-one bottles that you put water in and it makes soup. And we've had people coming back and saying, oh, it was like Christmas for them. And we're thinking, okay, we felt bad. But you make the choice and you see the difference. So it's not about giving this major thing. It's what's from the heart. So if we make the correct choices, again, I'm going back, corporates, government, individuals, children alike, to just report that incident of abuse, go to the police station, get the case number. We have NPOs on the ground, report it to us afterwards, say, here's the case number, assist us to follow the trail of this case. We will gladly do so. I'm going to give you the Human Trafficking, National Human Trafficking Resource Line, 0800-222-777. It's run by 821. You can report anything anonymously. info@actafrica.org.za. I insist on black and white. Anything in black and white leaves out the broken telephone situation. Email us. We'll chat to you. We'll talk to you and we'll act on your behalf, and we will not, you will be, if you want to be anonymous, it will be anonymous, but make the choice. So today I leave you with that, and I thank you for the choice you all made today to attend this conference and make the difference. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so, so much. Well, ACT Africa is doing a lot. You know, they're really, really active in our community. I'm going to make a choice for all of us and say it's lunch. We will be back at 1 o'clock, 1:30. Am I correct? Or
20 past one.
Let's make that choice and eat and come back, please. Thank you so much.